hard infrastructure and the soft infrastructure of cities. Fundamentally, my job is to make cities better for people like you. So for about 12 years I've been running my company, Place Partners, which is a consultancy, and a couple of years ago we started Place Score. And what's really exciting about Place Score is its aim is to provide the evidence-based first sort of human-centric planning of cities. And what's even more exciting is it gets people like me out of the way and people like you, so that you can directly tell government and developers what's important to you and how you're rating and experiencing, I guess, the lived experience of your urban environments, of your town centres and your neighbourhoods. So up until kind of, I guess, just even last week, there's been about 13,500 Australians who have participated in one of our surveys. We kind of consider it like a place census. It's the new way of kind of being able to drill down and really understand and capture the values of the community around their environment, what's actually really important to you, particularly kind of when you're decoupled from place, and instead of starting to go, how should we change that? It's about actually what's really important to us, and so we can actually prioritise investment around that. So we have been on the ground here in Beenleigh over the last month collecting data in two ways. So we've been doing town centre care factor, and also we've been doing street-based PX assessments, they're the place experience assessments. Can I just have a show of hands, who's participated in one of the surveys? Oh, not as many as we would like. The good news is, since I don't have a screen at the moment, I can just talk. I've got time actually running down. If you haven't done it, I know you've just been online doing a survey already, but the care factor is still live, so you can actually, if you want to do it, it's www.placescore.org/NSW. Don't worry about the NSW, it still collects data for your place, and we can actually provide that to council after today. And then we also did three assessments of streets in the town centre. So we did the town square. Now I'm going to forget the name of it. Someone's going to help me. It's a street that's straight in front. So is it George? No, that's that one. Yeah, and the street that's coming down here. And when we actually get these two data sets together, we can prioritise investment. So the idea is when we understand what you care about, and then we actually assess your places, you can cross-reference that data. So what you care about a lot and how it's rated is how we actually prioritise. So high care factor, low PX, high priority. Yeah, it makes complete sense. Yeah, we care about this thing, it's not doing so well, we should invest more in that. Inversely, high care factor, high PX, you're like, great, we're doing pretty good in that, we don't have to invest. So it's a really clear way to provide, as I said, governments and developers with a way to prioritise what's most important to you, so you don't spend money on things that aren't going to make a difference to your life, like to your day-to-day life. Any luck yet? The other thing that I want to talk to you is about how we actually choose the criteria. So there's two key things in placemaking, and it's all about kind of the way that you think about your cities and how they actually become successful. So it's about place attraction and place attachment. And our criteria are set from those and actually have been selected, the shortlisted by actually a panel of Australians from across the country. With place attraction, what we're talking about is what the magnet is. What are the things that actually draw people to a location? And these things can be physical things, they can be social, they can be cultural, but there can also be barriers to entry. So sometimes when we're going, oh, we can make something really sexy and it's really exciting and it's a great sort of wow factor, but there's things that are actually stopping us from actually going to that place. And the very simplest way is like I can look across the street and go, I want to go to that shop over there, it looks really interesting, but I'm looking for a place to cross the road and the crossing's over there and there's a whole lot of trucks going past. And that barrier becomes an instant kind of decision-making point that stops people from doing that. So in your town centre, you need to be thinking about how do we get people, but how do we reduce those barriers to entries? So they could be physical things, but they could be psychological. So going, actually, that place doesn't look like it. It's for me. It's full of a whole lot of young people, or it's full of families, and I'm not fitting in one of those things, so I don't think it's for me. And then the other part of that is attachment. And And again, for town centres, for successful town centres, this becomes really, really important. Thank you. It's about saying, once we've got people here, how do we actually extend their stay and also build meaningful relationships with them? So this is what we call it, the stickiness. So it's about the short-term thing, about slowing people down. So let's talk about your data. So as I mentioned, we were looking at town centres generally in terms of the care factor, and then we also did the PS assessment in town. Overall, there was 191 people who completed the care factor from the town centre, and 122 people who participated in the PS assessments out on the street. So I guess you're wondering kind of what is it that people really do care about. What's really interesting is to see the level of alignment and the level of sort of conflict between different attributes. So what we've got here is a high alignment of the community around the idea of cleanliness as being something that's important to them in the town centre. But still in the top 10, 42% of the population are saying that things to do in the evening. So we've got quite a good range of things here that people are saying are important. What I thought was interesting though, with this particular data set, and I can promise you, all data sets are completely different. Every community is just has its own unique values. Is that you had three of kind of the things to do category in your top 10. So there's a real sort of appetite, I think, in this area for more social activities, more opportunities to socialise and connect. Anyone notice something that's completely missing out of the top 10? So that what's in your ideal town centre? What do we always think is the biggest problem in the town centre? Car parking, yeah. So actually for you, car parking was number 11 out of 50 attributes. There's 10 things that your community, your customers, are saying are more important to them than car parking and accessibility. We can also start to segment this data down so you can really go into your customer bases and try and understand, again, where that alignment is and where that difference is between genders, between ages, people's country of birth, their ancestry, and even the type of neighbourhood they currently live in. And that actually is a really interesting one, particularly if you're going into a period of change where things might be denser. So you're going, well, what are people who are currently living in denser environments actually like? How do we provide things for them because they're going to be our future customers? Also kind of looking at your immediate catchment, like the people who are in your walkable catchment versus people across the LGA. So what I thought was really interesting here is that people who actually live in Beenleigh suburb, they actually value five different attributes than the average across the whole data set. And so we can start again saying, oh, okay, well, these are the people that are going to be coming every single day, walking through our town centre. How do we really make sure that we're looking after them? How do we actually make sure that we're providing for their day-to-day needs? Because they are your most loyal customers. They're the people that are actually going to be saying, let's meet in town to go to the shops or have dinner. You might be also interested in seeing kind of what another area values. So we actually, Bundaberg just closed this morning, so the data is a couple of hundred above that at the moment. So they too have cleaned this up in front, but they've got outdoor restaurant, cafe and bar seating as their number two care factor. And then you'll see they've got car accessibility and parking as number three. That's the highest that car parking accessibility has been in any of those surveys that we've done across the country for 13,000 people. And I think this is really interesting. And one of the things for Bundaberg is that it actually has very limited public transport and it has a very, very big catchment where cars are actually the only way to access the town centre. So the more modal choice you have, the better the walkability, the better the public transport, the less cars are actually valued. And when we all know that actually, you know, people driving past or trying to find parks aren't actually out shopping, we need to get people in front of your businesses to make them successful. We can start looking at what the different age groups are here. So I thought it was interesting that the 25 to 44 year olds, amenities and facilities, actually that's different from the overall top 10. So this group wants this, they value this more than anybody else. And I think what we probably find if we look at the census data is that these are also the people who are more likely to have young families. So So if they come into town, they need to be able to look after those children. And this is one of the things that main streets and malls quite often compete against, is that convenience of knowing that there's a clean bathroom. So if you're going to feed your children in town, you're very likely needing to go to your bathroom. So you might choose actually to go to a mall versus going to a main street. So it's something that we can do to change in a really simple way. So on the other side of saying what we care about is how we're actually assessing the places now. We we just provide the algorithm, each place out of 100. So the three places that we looked at were the Town Square, City Road and Main Street. And you can see here there's quite a big difference between the different scores. This is the lived place experience, how things are contributing positively or negatively to your customers' experience, to your communities. So 68 out of 100 for Town Square, which is a great score, and 48 and 49 for City Road and Main Street, an overall combined score of 57. This provides us with an excellent baseline benchmark for improvement. So it's nice to have this score, but obviously we want to know what's behind that. What are the things that are actually contributing positively or negatively? So these are the top three place attributes for each location, and they're quite similar across. What we're seeing here is a really well-functioning town. Like, it's got all the bits that you need. It's got the amount of public space, the quality of it. The walkability is actually good as well. Services and groceries are good. But what's not working so well are the things that make a place more unique and interesting, a place that you want to spend time in. That, you know, that all those activity-based things. So things to do in the evening is coming up here, public art, unusual or unique businesses, one-of-a-kind quirky or unique features. So there's an appetite here of saying, going, this, what we've got here might be a little bit homogenous. How do we actually provide a bit of diversity? So as I said at the beginning, when we bring these two data sets together, we can actually start to prioritise. So overall, this is on the left-hand side of your top 10 care factors across the whole centre, and on the right is how each of those are performing. So the overall visual character of the area is rated at number 9 in terms of the care factor, and it's performing at just minus 2, so that means it's just 2 points off that position, so it's actually 11th in the PS assessment. The way that we kind of guide people around this is saying anything that's kind of minus 10 or below is an area you should start thinking about investing in, because there's a gap between kind of what the expectations or what the desire is versus how they see it working today. So right down the bottom here, things to do in the evening, shopping, dining, entertainment, etc., is the 10th most important care factor, and it's performing at minus 40. There's a lot of room for improvement in that area. Outdoor restaurants, sense of safety, vegetation, again, evidence of public events, and maintenance getting up. So you've got some things you're doing really well at and some things that you can do with more help. And then we can break this down for each location. So if you're going to invest specifically in each street or place, you can have different aspects. And there'll be some things that across the whole town centre you can look at programmatically and thinking, how can we all contribute to this? And then some things that might be really site-specific. I won't go through them all in detail, but you can see here again, Town Square is doing really well. Then we've got Sea Road, which is performing sort of more poorly across multiple things. So elements of the natural environment here is the poorest performing at minus 43. So what are the ways that we might be able to integrate that into that street? And then back here again at Main Street, I think here sense of safety has really dropped down to minus 35. When you guys are talking at your tables, it might be interesting going like, why do we feel that way? Is this street actually less safe? What are the things that are contributing? Is there different types of nighttime economy? Is it businesses? Is it the fact there's no nighttime economy, so it feels less safe? Is it darker? Is it physical? Is it social? Is it cultural? And how we might be able to improve that. So the key themes that I saw from this research, and obviously we look at this with multiple places, is that really the things that your community, you guys are actually telling us, is that it's a real desire to make your streets in your town centre a much more social place. It needs more things to do, more expression of things to do, so even having dining outside is a way of activating the streets and making them feel more lively. Think about an evening and what kind of community activities could we add in? These could be really simple things. They that don't have to be really expensive, that don't have to be big markets. I'm going to show you a couple of examples in a moment. The second is the integration of street trees and vegetation. So I think it's coming across in two of the different place dimensions. One, in terms of just look and action, I think providing kind of that uniform kind of connectivity on the streets, providing a bit of shelter, but also in terms of uniqueness, about how you can use vegetation to make yourselves look different. Right now in Sydney, it's jacaranda season, it's springtime, and you know you're in Sydney in spring because of the jacarandas. So vegetation can really be a way to help you to distinguish yourselves. And respecting and highlighting local heritage, art, culture, heritage interpretation. And again, this doesn't have to be just putting a static piece of art or just sort of looking at heritage buildings, but it's actually also the living heritage and the sort of the culture that you guys have. And this could be through food, which was mentioned before, in one of the box pops. It could be through performance. It could be just through sharing kind of the stories that are in your community, that great diversity of ethnicity. How do we actually bring that to life out in the street? So a few examples of just some smaller projects. I know there's lots of big, grandiose projects that cost bazillions of dollars, but if you don't have bazillions of dollars, there's things you can get started with right now. This is actually a project we did back, we started in 2010 in Drummoyne, which is in Sydney. It's on Victoria Road. It's about 80,000 cars going down it a day, and the New South Wales roads think that we're going to make it all the clear way. So all the businesses, of course, got really worried and upset that we weren't going to have anyone being able to park at all on the street. So we did a lot of research with the community there, as well as with the businesses, to try and understand what it was that was really missing. And what we found is that even though we had very small amounts of public space, they weren't being utilised to actually make them into nice places for human beings. So on the left-hand side, you can actually see there's two tiny little trees there kind of sticking out. The council had already spent, by the time we came on, about $15,000 replacing those trees almost like once a month, because as the people came out of the pub, they thought it was kind of fun to give them a little flick. So we had this problem of the trees not being able to be looked after, this tiny bit of public space that we had not being able to be used by human beings. Part of the changes to the roads meant that it took longer to cross the it was a shorter crossing time, so it was actually much harder for people to cross the road, so the people on the other side of the street were actually suffering real financial changes. And that they were planning on spending a whole lot of money on building a landmark. In fact, they put $100,000 to put some sort of signage on it here. This project cost $14,000. It's actually four park benches and four plant boxes. It protects the trees, and look how beautiful they are. This is actually, now they're actually even bigger. They've got fairy lights in them, and it's probably one of our best known projects. There's got artworks that are wrapped around the planter boxes, and we can come back and say, test again with the community. This actually was the project that was considered to have the biggest impact on the business and the community. This is a project in Melbourne, so this is a laneway project. So nobody was walking down this little laneway, even though it was crossing between blocks. And one of the things that we identified is that people didn't feel welcome. So it was, again, that attraction. Going, people didn't know the top picture, was it a private place or was it a public place? So we did this installation, and there was this whole series of works, but it wasn't just about changing the public realm. It was actually about getting the right mix of businesses and working with the businesses to activate this place at extended hours particularly. So what we started was sort of a rotating roster of the businesses that would stay open on a Thursday night, because it's actually a business policy, so Friday nights people were rushing home, so that wasn't going to work for us, Friday night drinks. But Thursday night was a really great opportunity for people to socialise. So we had two things working, programs with businesses as well as improvements. And again, this is about that shared responsibility. This is Penrith City Centre. So on the left-hand side, you can see there used to be a road there. On the right-hand side was a temporary pop-up. This was a $40,000 spend. The community designed it over one day. It was a pretty exciting project for council to release into the hands of sort of a creative community. We had a kit of parts that were all pre-priced. And we actually had it built a month later. It provided 1,500 square metres of new open space to the community, had set up a kind of triggered what we were hoping for, which has happened, which is a sort of food precinct of outdoor dining. What it meant was that people in Penrith could bring their children to have dinner and have a safe place for the kids to be running around while people could sit down. So it's actually something that, again, was really needed. So there's types of things that I'd be saying to think about when you're thinking about transformation is keeping that human side of it, really kind of going, yes, we want the aspirations, but technology just on its own actually doesn't make a great place for human beings. By collaborating the way that you guys are, you're actually really being empowered to participate in kind of planning your future together. But it also means that you need to participate in making those changes happen, because it can't be done by one person. Our data shows kind of like what everyone values, but it also means that we have to build that culture of providing that environment for our community, for our businesses, and obviously them as customers also. Thank you.